just me. It's everybody here today that is trying to do amazing good. So thank you very much for showing up so darn early. It was cold a while ago. It's no longer cold, is it? It's not cold. Here are my gloves. I'm putting them on the podium. Well, anyway, thank you so much. When, actually, I've got a little talk, but I'm not going to give it yet. I'm going to introduce our first speaker. So we have, we'll be hearing from four people today. Christina, who is a survivor of child abuse, and then three keynote speakers, nationally known speakers, that are experts on this subject and have some really poignant things to share with us. Okay, Christina Freeman, a personal friend of mine. She's a survivor of abuse from age 3 until 15 years old. She's doing her best to live a successful life in spite of her tormented past. As a graduate of BYU with a major in English and a minor in art, she has worked as a residential coach for troubled teens, then as a therapist for autistic children. By sharing her truth, she has high hopes to eliminate the epidemic of child abuse. Christina.
Love you, Christina.
Like Sam said, my name is Christina Freeman, and I'd like to say that I have an extreme case of dissociative identity disorder. That's multiple personalities. And today I'd like to tell you my story. I remember the moment my mother saw us. I could feel my father tensing up. He had carelessly left the door open that night when he came in to molest me. She saw him, his hands violating my 14-year-old body as I lay petrified in sweaty sheets. He tried to invite her in as if nothing was happening, but it was too late. She could see that there was a problem. She confronted him that night. I'm told he curled up in the fetal position and cried, "I'm sick, I'm sick, I'm sick." First, my mom had my dad talk to the bishop, who did call Child Protective Services, who did call the police, but the police reports don't line up with what happened. They admit at least 9 years of abuse. My testimony also neglected the truth. I was only 14, I loved my dad, and I was sorely confused. I spared my dad decades of prison, but I was not able to spare him from the bane of his inflictions. In addition to being a member of the bishopric, my dad was a popular Spanish teacher at the high school he happened to be at when the police arrested him. His arrest made the news. Local high school teacher charged of molesting a minor. We don't know if the victim is male or female, just that they are leaving the state. And I did. I left California and arrived in Provo the night before my freshman year of high school started. My parents didn't want anyone to know what I had been through. I did my best to comply with their desire for silence. I held my suffering deep inside. Trauma can take a while to manifest. For years, I seemed all right. I stayed active in high school. I managed to get into BYU. I felt far sorrier for my father than I did for me. I even wrote a song to convey my mercy. It's called The Sinner. The Sinner is about the woman who washed Christ's feet with her tears. The Pharisees judged her, but Christ loved her. I wanted people to know that making the worst mistake doesn't make you the worst person. Like the priest in Les Mis, I wanted the world to pardon and forgive. The song has come to mean more over time. It's not just about my father's suffering. It's about mine. As the years continued, my afflictions increased. My confidence diminished. I could never sleep in a hellish spiral of sabotage defeat. I lost jobs. I lost friends. I lost my identity to a raging nymphomaniac whose torment knew no end. From the depths of my childhood hurt, these dark entities began to emerge. But even with all these altars, I felt alone. I love my family, and they love me. But when they all took my father's side, I felt I had no home. You see, my dad is an upstanding member of the church. I am an apostate, wild and cursed by iniquity. That is what my family prefers to believe. I have come to know that their ignorance is a part of a more destructive whole. Just like my father said he is sick, the LDS Church needs to admit that they have a problem. Utah ranks number one in the country for sexually abusing children. They rank number one. And I have something to say to President Nelson. Dear Prophet, you need to stop the monsters who hide in the dark. You need to stop, and you need to start creating a faith where the children are safe, where teenagers pray to a God who hates shame. It really isn't my family I blame. It's their skewed sense of righteousness that needs to change. You offer abusers a liberal grace, but how do you tend to their ailing prey? Poor black lamb, be happy, don't fornicate. Repent, dear, move forwards. What made you hate? These are all words I've heard bishops say, and this is why I sing, to rectify the needs of your sacrificial sheep. Let mercy extended to oppressors be mirrored by proper atonement for wrongdoing, not just offering an apology, but acknowledging and compensating for the damages that accrue from childhood sexual abuse. Your daughters aren't whores, they are victims of wars that rage in the heads of the men too repressed to keep going. Do not scourge, then ignore the hurt that's growing. I'm an artist, a musician, and a writer. Later today, I will be kickstarting a profile on Facebook called There's a Problem. There's a Problem will detail the entire story of my views and offer insights on what we can do to create change. It is time to end these cycles caused by shame.